Hello everyone, Martin here, and welcome to this breakdown video to show you a bit of behind the scenes of one of my Blender environments. One that is actually the cover of the Master 3D Environments course in Blender, which is now finished, and you now have the last chance to get a 25% discount because the early access is ending. This Lone Mountain scenery is actually the very first workflow I show you in the course, and there I try to redeem the reputation of the built-in ANT landscape add-on, which many Blender users consider useless. Well, in my opinion, it's not. Not by a long shot. All the steps that I'm going to show you are of course broken down in the course. And a little note for those of you who've already gone through the chapter, I've taken the feedback from the early access stage and I've expanded some of the lessons that some students had problem with, especially when I did not go linearly or step by step. The way I've gone about this scene is, I first searched for reference images of the sort of environment I wanted to make. Though the very first one I gathered, this wonderful key shot from the second Hobbit movie, actually remained as the main source of inspiration for me. Nevertheless, I knew I wanted to make it a little bit more forested, so that's what the other images helped with. I started with creating the actual mountain. As mentioned, I used ANT and a mountainous preset for this, and then played around with the settings a bit to achieve a slightly more iconic look. You can see some of the settings that I chose here, and this gave me a nice base mesh. A key part of making this mountain was adding enough surface detail. And the problem is, ANT usually doesn't give you enough detail right off the bat. So to solve that, I've added a displace modifier on my mesh, and into it I plugged in a rocky displacement map, which then displaced my subdivided terrain. The more subdivisions you have, the more detail you get, at the cost of performance, of course. This, however, really helped me sell all the detail on the mountain, and combined with normal maps later, it gave me lots of visual interest. With that, I was able to blend in several BSDF shaders with snow and rock textures, and using a mixing network, I was able to get a nice random blend between them, giving me this result. A handy trick that you can use for texture mixing is utilizing the built-in erosion add-on. I mean, in my opinion, its erosion effects are not the best, and they take forever. Nevertheless, they automatically generate amazing weight maps for you, which you can then easily convert to vertex colors in the vertex paint mode with this option here. And this way, you can utilize these vertex maps in the factor sockets of your mix shader or RGB mix nodes. And it's a very handy option when you're using ANT Landscape. By the way, all of the textures I used were free from a website formerly known as CC0 Textures, now ambientcg.com. They're all still CC0 though, so it remains an invaluable resource for free texture images. Blending of materials and blending of displacements, that was the main part of making this mountain work. I had my own settings for blending snow and rock onto this mountain, but this is actually a great example where students were able to help me. My network was very convoluted, giving me lots of randomness at the cost of simplicity. So I was actually recommended to make a network like this, just using three nodes, sourcing the mountain's normal map, then separating just the Z-channel from it, and adjusting it with color ramp. This elegant solution is one of the possibilities you can map a snow to your horizontal areas and rock to vertical ones, fast and easy. Once I've finished with that, I was able to proceed to adding more elements to the scene. First, there was a very simple water surface. I made it circular, a trick that I do to be able to get rid of visible corners in the distance. I've used the vector displacement sequence that I generated and baked in Blender using the super awesome ocean generator. In chapter 4 I provide this sequence, so I did not go too detailed with this water element. I just plugged the sequence into the displacement socket using a vector displacement node. I played with the strength to make it a little more apparent, and with Ctrl T I added a mapping network. I changed the mapping for the texture to be somewhat more repeated. What mattered was how it looks in the camera view, and here the repetition looked fine. I then edited the BSDF settings like this, having maximum specularity, some metalness and zero roughness with black color. And this is how you make a water surface like this very fast. Rest assured though, there is a whole chapter 11 dedicated to this water topic, and you'll be able to achieve much more elaborate ocean surfaces there. Next up, there was a sky element, which was simply enough just a flat image plane. This is actually what I always attempt to do, using just a little bit of effort, but adding tons of details with it. You just need to be careful so that those images fit your foreground when it comes to the amount of detail, the horizon line, and the coloring. Otherwise, it gets quite apparent real quick. Then, I just used ANT Landscape again, used similar settings as I did before, only I repurposed it for these foreground pieces of landscape. At the time of making this course, geometry nodes were still a thing of the future, so I relied on good old particle systems. And with them, I have scattered lots of trees and little rocks that I got from this wonderful package at PlanSwap. Then it was also dust planes, using transparent image textures that I provide in the course, and also little ice pieces that we generate using the built-in rock generator directly in Blender. You just activate it in the settings and add-ons, search for the extra objects add-on, and then find it in the add menu. I found a preset that worked for me and adjusted the settings like this, also made 10 variations here, and then squashed the rock on Z-axis, effectively making it an ice piece. Fast and easy. I then just distributed these particles onto the surface of my lake using a particle setup. Obviously, the final scene was quite heavy. That's, however, where the render layers and compositing helped. This is a workflow that I utilize in each chapter of the course, and though it may seem that it slows down the process, keeping you from the wonderful final render, well, the exact opposite is the case. Separated render layers help you render your scenes faster, or sometimes at all, and by dicing the render into layers and thus being able to render each one separately, I was able to render various parts of the image to be later put together in compositing stage. The way I put this together was I divided everything by the scene's depth. So I have foreground layers, midground layers, and background layers all diced up into separate collections, and based on that, into render layers, which are basically presets controlling which collections are activated and which deactivated. And once you start compositing scenes, you will quickly find out how very powerful this process is, since it gives you the ability to not only put together your final image, but also to really fine-tune the blending of various elements and even add extra ones on top. For example, I could blend in these gradient textures, achieving a really nice light scattering effect. Rest assured, the course includes an introduction to this topic, one that I plan to release for free here on this very YouTube channel in the near future. So, I hope that breaking down this environment gave you a bit clearer idea of what creating such a scene entails. Together, I tried for this course to give you a versatile toolbox for you to be able to create any 3D environment you wish. And it really makes me happy to see the student results, kinda confirming this idea. Alright guys, it's been a very long journey for me on this course, but it's finally done. Well, not completely, I'll be improving it constantly, even based on your feedback, and I'll be also adding some bonus content later, especially when Blender 3.0 comes out and the geometry nodes will reach their more or less final stage of development. Before that, however, you can already enjoy 12 hours of content, focusing on all sorts of different environment types and techniques. So that's it from me for today. Hope you enjoyed this brief breakdown, and I also hope to see you in one of my courses. Stay creative, my friends. Martin out.